Good morning. Welcome to St. Thomas Swansea's online worship this morning. My name is Steve and I'm the vicar here in St. Thomas. Today we're continuing our series on Relentless Good News. It's going to be the last of our online explorations in Matthew's Gospel because we're now entering the season of Advent, the preparation for Christmas. And we're going to be doing something slightly different over the coming weeks. We're also hoping to be together in person very soon. We are. I know we've been saying that now for many weeks, but we are snowballing towards the end of our redevelopment now in St. Thomas, and we're hoping very soon to release details of booking for our normal worship on a Sunday and, of course, for our Christmas celebrations. Things will look a little bit different this year than it has done in the past, but that's not going to stop us getting together to celebrate the good news that is the coming of Jesus at Christmas. Today we're going to have worship led by our worship pastor Mark, and he's also going to preach to us today on that final part of Matthew chapter 9. But before that, we're just going to take a moment on this Sunday morning just to come into the presence of God and to ask him to reveal to us where we're falling short, where we're missing the mark, as the Bible calls sin. The thing that separates us from our relationship with God and with each other. And so we're just going to be still for a moment, calling to mind those things we need to confess. And then together we will confess by following the words on the screen. And we pray together. Father, forgive us from when we have received your love without loving others, your blessings without giving to others, your compassion without caring for others, your mercy without forgiving others, and your salvation without speaking to others. Amen. And so, may Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you and set you free from sin, strengthen you in goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. We're now going to sing together as Mark leads us in worship songs this morning. Let us sing out our praise to the Lord.
Well, hi there, brothers and sisters. I'm hoping that this is one step back towards worshipping together as a whole church. I've got to say, I cannot wait to have the singers and musicians alongside me to be discovering the musical gifts in this community. And what better way to use our musical gifts than to worship the King of Kings, who loves us more than we could ever imagine, to worship before the throne of God above. And that's what we're going to do now.
Lives
And now Rachel is going to lead us in our prayers of intercession today.
We pray for our church and for the world. We bring before you the Diocese of Swansea and Brecon, our Bishop John, and for all clergy working in this area. We pray for Steve and for Mark. As we begin to head into our busy time of year, we pray for anybody who is in charge of leading people to faith, for this will be a time where we use the good news of your birth to reach out to people and to help to bring your love to the world. We hold before you our local community here in St. Thomas. We pray for our friends and neighbours, for the children who go to our local schools and all the teachers who support them there, for those in Danegraig, St. Thomas and Kevin Hengoyd. We give you thanks for all the people in our local community who look out for each other, who support their neighbours, who care for the vulnerable. We continue to give you thanks for our NHS and other key workers as they support everyone who's been affected by the COVID crisis. We hold before you all the people who come to our church for help, for those who make use of the food bank and Baby Basics. And we give you thanks for all those who work to support those people. We pray for the children in our Boys Brigade as we return this week, for all those in Anchors, Juniors and Company. We pray for them and their families. We pray for all those who are sick at this time, for those who are suffering in mind, body or spirit. We bring before you all those who are in hospital and facing time on their own, all those who are being cared for at home, and all those who are suffering with no one to care for them. We pray that you'll know their comfort and your peace. We bring before you all those who are mourning the loss of a loved one. In particular this week, we pray for the family of David Dwyer. And we pray for all those whose anniversary of death falls at this time and the family that are left to remember them. In a moment of quiet, we bring you our own prayers for the week ahead, for our friends and loved ones and the situations that we know. We bring you these and all our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Just to say, just to reaffirm earlier, just with regards to notices, our Boys Brigade and Girls Association is back going every Wednesday. Do get in touch with us if your child wants to be on the waiting list. At the moment, we're just trying to settle back into the rhythm of people that we had before. Relatively soon, we'll be looking at relaunching our toddler groups, our other Christmas family activities. They'll all be coming out soon. We'll also be taking those bookings for our normal worship and our Christmas worship online. Our midweek service will be running this week, and more details about the time and date of that will be in our newsletter and will be advertised through our social media channels. And just a reminder again, on Tuesday we gather to learn some of these new songs in St Stephen's Church. Do contact the office to book yourself in, or for your household in, just so we can go through the rules and regulations. I know it's a pain in the bottom when we're trying to just worship the Lord, but we've also got to make sure we're safe, we're covered, and that nobody gets ill through gathering together to worship Jesus. We're now going to have our reading and then our talk. First of all, Katie Grace with our reading. And then Mark, our student pastor, bringing us today's Relentless good news.
Chapter 9. As Jesus went on from there, two blind men followed him, calling out, "Have mercy on us, Son of David." When he had gone indoors, the blind men came to him, and he asked them, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" "Yes, Lord," they replied. Then he touched their eyes and said, "According to your faith, let it be done to you." And their sight was restored. Jesus warned them sternly, "See that no one knows about this." They went out and spread the news about him all over that region. While they were going out, a man who was demon-possessed and could not talk was brought to Jesus. And when the demon was driven out, the man who had been mute spoke. The crowd was amazed and said, "Nothing like this has ever been seen in Israel." But the Pharisees said, "It is by the prince of demons that he drives out demons."
At the age of 17, I got one of the most exciting opportunities of my life. It was to take part in an expedition to the Himalayas, the highest mountain range on Earth. Now, preparations for that were grueling in terms of physical fitness. Had to get really, really fit. I actually found the financial preparations even tougher because I had to earn all of the money myself. I ended up, it was a fairly miserable penultimate year at school, where I was at school 5 days a week, and then I was working at Sainsbury's not just one day but 2 days at a weekend, which is not a pattern I would ever recommend actually to anybody working solidly 7 days out of seven. But it was worth it in the end, and to be a bit cheesy, the high point was the high point. When we got to the amazing pinnacle of the mountain trek that we were doing in a deep mountain pass called the Pin Parbati Pass, it was just an absolutely spectacular day, 5,200 metres up, surrounded by some of the biggest mountains in the world. And I still remember when we went up to that peak that day, and actually how with the team that I was with, how the reactions were really quite different. So for some people, they just wanted to be up there and be quiet and take in the spectacular beauty of the Himalayas. For others, the main thing that they, or perhaps we, were interested in was posing for the camera and making sure we got the great photo that we could keep with us for the rest of our lives. In fact, one other thing, as well as doing a little bit of posing myself, the other thing I did at the time, it wasn't long after the Titanic film was made with Leonardo DiCaprio and Kate Winslet, and when I got up there, I, just like Leo does in Titanic, I went, "I'm the king of the world!" I was just absolutely elated in that moment, and for some reason, that's what came out. And a few others had similar sort of dramatic reactions as well. But it's got to be said that some were also grumbling as well. That was one of the other reactions we saw that day. They were just grumbling because other people weren't reacting to it in the way they thought we should be doing. But that mountaintop experience elicited a mix of reactions. And I'm sure you know all about mixed reactions yourself. I mean, whether it's to do with the recent presidential election, whether it's to do with the decisions that have been made about school exams during COVID season, whether it might be to do with my and Steve's dance moves that are going to be returning shortly to TikTok. But mixed reactions are something we're very familiar with. And today, in today's Bible reading, we also see that Jesus himself encountered mixed reactions. And we're going to see three of them in today's passage. And they all begin with P. A preliminary reaction, a proud reaction, and a progressive reaction. The preliminary reaction, the proud reaction, and the progressive reaction. So first of all, the preliminary response. And we see this in verse 33 in response to the second recorded miracle in this passage. So there is a mute, a man who has been unable to speak for his entire life. And he's brought to Jesus. And 5 minutes later, he speaks his first words. And of course, that is the most wonderful miracle because it's transformed his life and his future. Communication is so important, isn't it? And so being given that gift of communication, no longer being mute, completely transformed his future. What a wonderful moment. And it goes on, Matthew goes on to describe, the crowd was amazed and said, nothing like this has ever been seen in Israel. And there's that first reaction to Jesus, amazement. Amazement. Amazement is the preliminary reaction when you're starting to discover the real Jesus. And notice what they say. They say, nothing like this has ever been seen in Israel. And it's important to notice that detail because it's telling us that these weren't gullible people. These weren't necessarily people who just believed anyone whenever they said, oh, I've seen a miracle or I've seen an angel. No, they're saying that they'd heard about miracles before, but they said, we've never seen anything like this before. And remember, Jesus was utterly unique. Jesus did thousands of miracles with thousands of witnesses. As I've said before, the evidence is remarkable. And even if you're skeptical about other miraculous claims, Jesus is in his own category. I remember a guy called Joe, who I was looking at all of the big questions of life with, and he said something really fascinating later on. He said, do you know what? Before I looked into it, I thought that reason was on the side of atheism. But now that I've actually looked into it, I see that there are better reasons for believing that Christianity is true than for believing that atheism is true. It's so fascinating what people come to when they actually investigate the evidence. I love this quote from Herbert Spencer. He said this, there is a principle which cannot fail to keep a man in everlasting ignorance, contempt prior to investigation. That is, if someone is skeptical, skepticism is fine if you've actually looked into things. But if you're skeptical before you've looked into things, well, that's just contempt prior to investigation. That is not a justified skepticism. So it's always important, if someone is skeptical about faith, to ask them, well, have you actually looked into it? Have you actually looked into it yet? But when someone is actually looking into it and is beginning to understand Christianity, the preliminary reaction you get is amazement. But as I said, that is only the preliminary reaction. And why? Well, because you've then got to act on that amazement. And this takes us on to the other two reactions. And number two is the proud reaction. Now, this is the reaction that we get with the Pharisees. So they see the miracle. They see the love and the power of God at work. But tragically, their reaction is controlled by pride. And so in verse 34, they just sneer and say, ah, it's by the prince of demons that Jesus drives out demons. Such a strange and tragic response. Maybe you've seen that kind of thing before, in that kind of person who just cannot bring themselves to rejoice at good news. That person who refuses to share in the joy of others, whether out of bitterness or jealousy or pride. But that it's that kind of person who hardens their heart rather than celebrating a miracle or a blessing from God. And important to notice that one of the differences that as somebody grows up as a Christian is that they learn to thank God, not just when they're blessed themselves, but also when other people are blessed. They celebrate whenever they see God doing something wonderful in someone's life. But tragically, the Pharisees just could never bring themselves to do that. They refused to rejoice. And with that, they refused to change or to repent, as the Bible calls it. And so they always saw Jesus as a threat rather than a blessing. One of the things I love to do at Christmas is to get together with my godchildren and make gingerbread together. And we have lots of fun making all sorts of different shapes. And then, of course, eating gingerbread as we watch a Christmas film or something like that. And of course, with gingerbread, you can just make your own man. You can make your own woman. You can make your own whatever. But when it comes to the Messiah or God, you can't make your own Messiah. You can't make your own God. You've got to have Jesus on his terms, not your terms. Because that's who he is. But sadly, that's what the Pharisees wanted to do. They wanted the Messiah on their terms or not at all. And so they preferred to curse the king than change their ways. And that is the proud reaction, and it's a very natural reaction. But in the end, it brings no happiness. If you see Jesus as a threat, you'll never know the joys and the blessings and the peace and the purpose that he came to give. But then there's the third reaction, the progressive reaction. And I know the word progressive is used for all sorts of beliefs and agendas these days, especially political ones. But I mean it in its just pure literal sense. The reaction to Jesus, the progressive reaction that brings genuine, unambiguous progress in a person's life. And we see this with the two blind men in verse 27. So they've heard about what Jesus was doing, and they're open-minded, and they believe that he might be able to help them too. So they cry out to him, "Have mercy on us, son of David." They come to him with boldness. They're unembarrassed to say, "We believe, Jesus, you are the Messiah," because that's what the son of David means. And then so they go inside, and Jesus asks about their faith, and they say, "Yes, Lord, we believe that you can heal us. We don't believe that other people can, but we believe you're different." And their eyes are opened. Their faith in Jesus leads to this longed for blessing. The progressive reaction is to believe that Jesus can do what no one else can do. And the most wonderful blessings follow. Now, there's certainly more to this passage than I've been able to touch on today. For example, those blind men, actually, it turns out it wasn't just a progressive reaction, it was also a partial reaction. Because their faith wasn't immediately followed by obedience to Jesus. No, there was still more progress that needed to come after that. But let's just focus on these three reactions today. And let me ask you this. Which of these three reactions to Jesus do you choose? Which do you choose? Have you explored enough to be amazed? Well, that's the first step, the preliminary step. But it needs to then be followed by a decision. And like the Pharisees, we can choose pride. We can if we want to. But know this, if you do, you'll never find joy. And by the way, this is also an ongoing challenge for Christians as well. Whenever our joy is at a low ebb, we need to ask the Lord, "Lord, is there some pride that's getting in the way here? Is there some pride that is actually cutting off my joy?" And very often, certainly in my life anyway, there is. But the best choice is the progressive reaction. Putting our faith in Jesus completely. Trusting him with everything and for everything. Because that's where the greatest blessings are found. And not just healing. No, the even greater ones. The blessings that Jesus secured on the cross at the cost of his life for all who put their faith in him. The blessing of forgiveness. Total forgiveness. The blessing of eternal life, perfect hope. The blessing of perfect and lasting peace. And of course, the blessing of everlasting joy.
Thank you so much to Mark for this week's talk on relentless good news and these opportunities to respond and these different ways of responding to the good news of Jesus. And I wonder where you are today. How are you responding? Perhaps with that initial kind of amazement, if that's you, if over the last few days, weeks, months, you've gradually become amazed by the good news of Jesus, this is an opportunity to respond, to go further. Maybe join us for one of our future Alpha courses next term after Christmas. Maybe press into the Bible or come to see us on a Tuesday or the midweek or just get in touch. We'll find ways of taking that amazement to a much deeper and rooted level. And maybe there are other things that are getting in the way. Maybe it's pride, maybe it's other things. And we just want to always give an opportunity because we long for people to have a real connected, life-changing encounter and relationship with Jesus Christ. So that's what we'll be praying for. Do get in touch if we can help in any way. My experience personally is that when we trust Jesus with everything, he will do more than we can possibly imagine. 18 months or so ago, I stood in St. Thomas Church with a floor that was collapsing, that had stuff stuck in the gaps where the rot was coming in, where water dripped in, where things were not great. And soon you'll be able to join me standing inside a new building where when we put our trust in Jesus, he has blessed us more than we can possibly imagine. We're going to sing again in a moment our final song about Jesus holding us fast in this time of transition and discipleship, just reflecting on the words of Mark's talk. But before that, I just want to pray for God's blessing on you this morning and your family. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be upon you and those who you love and pray for this day and always. Amen. Let us sing together our final song.
Saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast, precious in his holy sight. He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bought by him at such a cost. He will hold me fast. be found. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast.